Tag TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.
Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Yeshi Chansom. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Tuesday, the 6th of October. India's top court asks UP state government about witness protection in Hathras rape case. US envoy Khalilzad meets Afghan President Ghani in Qatar, discuss peace process. And former Sri Lankan President Sirisena denies responsibility for Easter Sunday attacks. And now for all the details. India's Supreme Court on Tuesday asked the Uttar Pradesh state government to file an affidavit detailing the witness protection efforts in Hathras case, in which a 19-year-old girl was allegedly gang-raped and subsequently died last week after suffering severe injuries. Meanwhile, protests have continued decrying inaction against the four accused who have been arrested but not charged.
India's Supreme Court on Tuesday asked the Uttar Pradesh state government to file an affidavit detailing the witness protection efforts on ground in the Hathras case, in which a 19-year-old girl was allegedly gang-raped and subsequently died after suffering severe injuries last week. The apex court hearing a PIL, public interest litigation in the case, which has triggered massive outrage and protests across the country, asked the state government to ascertain whether the victim's family has chosen a lawyer and the status of proceedings in the Allahabad High Court. The hearing in the case will resume next week.
जिसमें तमाम चीजों को लेकर के है, एक तो जिसमें सबसे बड़ा important है कि victim की जो family है, उसको security दी जा रही है कि नहीं दी जा रही है। दूसरा चीज है कि इलाहाबाद हाई कोर्ट भी जो है सू मोटो इसमें ले चुका है, तो इलाहाबाद हाई कोर्ट के स्टेटस क्या है, उसमें हियरिंग का क्या मकसद कहां तक पहुंच पाया है। तीसरा चीज लेकर के कहा है कि विक्टिम की फैमिली ने खुद भी अपना एडवोकेट अपॉइंट किया है कि नहीं अपॉइंट किया है।
मीनवाइल ऑपोजिशन कांग्रेस पार्टी लीडर राहुल गांधी ऑन ट्यूजडे क्वेश्चन्ड प्राइम मिनिस्टर नरेंद्र मोदी साइलेंस ओवर द हैंडलिंग ऑफ द हाथरस केस इन उत्तर प्रदेश, where the state government is led by his Bharatiya Janata Party.
बच्ची का रेप होता है, मर्डर होता है, पूरा एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन परिवार पर आक्रमण करता है और देश के प्रधानमंत्री एक शब्द नहीं कहते। इंटरेस्टिंग बात है।
Public criticism mounted in recent days after the victim's family said her body was cremated by police without their consent, an allegation officials deny. Protests have continued by opposition parties decrying inaction against the four accused who have been arrested but not charged.
As part of Unlock 5, India's Information and Broadcasting Ministry on Tuesday released the standard operating procedures for cinema halls and theatres, which are reopening from 15th of October. The theatres were shut about 7 months due to coronavirus pandemic and now will be available to the patrons with 50% capacity and one seat distance between them.
India's Information and Broadcasting Minister Prakash Javadekar on Tuesday confirmed that theatres across the country will be reopening from October 15. The theatres were shut for about 7 months due to coronavirus pandemic. According to the standard operating procedures released by the ministry, only 50% seating will be allowed of the total capacity and alternate seats will be left vacant for social distancing. Besides this, face masks will be mandatory inside the cinema halls. In these 7 months, several filmmakers opted for the digital release of their films on leading OTT platforms.
पिछले 7 महीने से सिनेमा हॉल बंद थे। गृह मंत्रालय के निर्णय के अनुसार अब वो 15 अक्टूबर से खुलेंगे। स्वास्थ्य मंत्रालय के सलाह से आईएनबी मिनिस्ट्री ने एक स्टैंडर्ड ऑफ प्रोसेस घोषित किया है, एसओपी घोषित किया है, स्टैंडर्ड ऑफ प्रोटोकॉल, और उसमें 50% लोग अलाउड होंगे।
Earlier on Monday, India's Western Maharashtra state, home to the financial hub of Mumbai, which accounts for the highest number of COVID-19 cases in the country, allowed bars and restaurants to start operations fully after over 6 months of coronavirus lockdown. Meanwhile, India's total coronavirus cases rose by 61,267 in the last 24 hours to 6.69 million on Tuesday morning. Deaths from COVID-19 infections rose by 884 to 103,569.
Moving on, activists have termed Pakistan's recent announcement to give provincial status to illegally occupied region of Gilgit-Baltistan as an unconstitutional move. They express concerns that China has been lobbying Pakistan to bring Gilgit-Baltistan under its legal jurisdiction to protect its investment in the region, which are part of the China-Pakistan economic corridor.
Political activists and experts have raised concern that Pakistan's recent announcement to turn Gilgit-Baltistan as its fifth province is in response to pressure from China in order to help protect investments as part of the multi-billion dollar China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, or CPEC. Speaking during a webinar, activists criticized the move to alter the status of the illegally occupied region and regarded it as unconstitutional. Gilgit-Baltistan, which is on CPEC's route, has witnessed regular protests over alleged human rights violations by Pakistani forces to muzzle dissent in the region against the so-called developmental project.
एक इतनी बड़ी investment जो China वहाँ पर कर रहा है, China को कम से कम Pakistan की legal jurisdiction में एक जगह पर जहाँ से उनका CPEC enter करेगा, वहाँ पर ambiguity नहीं चाहिए। वो ये नहीं चाहते हैं कि इसका लीगल स्टेटस जो है डिस्प्यूटेड रहे।
Along with moving ahead with its plan to make Gilgit-Baltistan as its province, Pakistan is also planning to hold elections to the so-called Gilgit-Baltistan Legislative Assembly on November 15. India has lodged a strong protest against the Pakistan government regarding this announcement, stating that Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh, including Gilgit-Baltistan, are an integral part of India.
Afghan President Ashraf Ghani, who visited Kuwait and Qatar where peace talks are underway, met U.S. Peace Envoy for Afghanistan Zalmi Khalilzad on Monday and discussed Afghan peace. Khalilzad said that the U.S. supports an Afghan-led, Afghan-owned process and remains ready to assist. Afghanistan's President Ashraf Ghani, who arrived in Qatar on Monday where peace talks are underway, met U.S. Special Envoy Zalmi Khalilzad and Scott Miller, General Commander for the U.S. and NATO troops in Afghanistan. Afghan Presidential Spokesman Siddiq Siddiqui, in a series of tweets, said that during the meeting, both sides stressed on the importance of these talks and the peace opportunity for ending the war and bringing an enduring peace. Asserting that violence in Afghanistan is too high despite the ongoing Afghan peace talks, Khalilzad said Washington is pressing for a significant reduction in violence that will lead to a permanent and comprehensive ceasefire. Khalilzad told Ghani that Afghans should not let the opportunity for peace to slip away and called on all nations, especially the neighbors and other key players, to do the same. Negotiations between the Afghan government and Taliban that started last month are aimed at the warring sides agreeing to a reduction of violence and a possible new power-sharing agreement in Afghanistan. However, the two sides of the talks have not yet started their direct negotiations. They are yet to agree on two matters. In news from Nepal, locals around the Pashupatinath temple in Nepal's capital Kathmandu on Monday staged a protest against the newly introduced master plan to make changes around the World Heritage and major religious site, claiming that it would endanger the ancient temple.
The locals around Pashupatinath temple in Kathmandu Valley on Monday staged a protest against the newly introduced master plan to make changes around the World Heritage and major religious site. Forming a protest committee, they protested in front of the Pashupati Area Development Trust, claiming that the plan would wipe out the ancient residents and threaten the heritage. The newly debated plan proposes to expand the area of the Pashupatinath temple by demolishing the current structures, excluding the main temple, to manage huge crowds of devotees by providing them with better facilities. Apart from the reconstructions of temples, some other temples damaged in 2015 earthquake are included in the plan.
यसको कारण भनेको चाहिँ पशु क्षेत्र विकास कोषले अहिले ल्याएको यो नयाँ गुरु योजनामा स्थानीय मैत्री नभएको र यो धर्म संस्कृति र सम्पदा मैत्री नभएको उहाँहरूले चाहिँ यो गुरु योजना बनाउँदाखेरि चाहिँ पशु क्षेत्र विकास कोषको कर्मचारीहरू पदाधिकारीहरू मात्र बसेर कुनै विज्ञलाई नराखिकन एकजना मान्छेलाई ठेकाको रूपमा दिएर
द न्यू प्लान रिक्वायर्स अ लार्ज पोर्सन अफ ल्यान्ड टु बी इम्प्लिमेन्टेड. A large number of families around Pashupatinath are likely to be displaced. Locals who have claimed that their residence date back to hundreds of years have refused to shift out, saying that the plan has failed to specify the concept, thus leaving doubts.
Moving on to news from Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka's former president Maithripala Sirisena on Monday appeared before the Presidential Commission of Inquiry probing the Easter Sunday attacks and denied he was privy to the prior intelligence on the deadly terror strikes. Sirisena will again appear on October 12th.
Sri Lanka's former President Maithripala Sirisena on Monday appeared before the Presidential Commission of Inquiry probing the Easter Sunday attacks. Testifying before the commission, Sirisena reiterated his stance that he should not take the responsibility for the Easter Sunday suicide bomb attacks on 21st April 2019 when he was the leader of the country. Sirisena said the attack could have been prevented if he had been informed of the intelligence received at least by a phone call prior to the attack. He stressed to the commission that former Defence Secretary Hemasiri Fernando and former Inspector General of Police Pujit Jayasundara should be held responsible for the failure to prevent the attack in which 258 people were killed. The previous government headed by Sirisena and Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe was blamed for its inability to prevent the attacks despite the prior intelligence made available on the impending attack. Sirisena will again appear before the commission on October 12th.
In news from Bangladesh, export earnings of Bangladesh in the first quarter of the current 2020-21 fiscal year grew 2.58% to nearly $10 billion. According to official data released on Monday, the country's export sector is limping back to normalcy after suffering serious blows due to COVID-19 pandemic.
Bangladesh's export earnings in the first quarter of the current 2020-21 fiscal year, that is July 2020 to June 2021, grew 2.58% year-on-year to nearly $10 billion, according to the official data released on Monday. The Export Promotion Bureau or EPB data showed Bangladesh earned a total of $9,896.84 billion from exports in July to September, compared to $9,647.99 billion last year. Of the total earnings, the country's income from ready-made garment items, including knitwear and woven, stood at $8.13 billion during the July to September period of the current fiscal year. The data shows the country's export sector is limping back to normalcy after suffering serious blows in the last fiscal year owing to COVID-19 impacts. Due to the pandemic, Bangladesh's export earnings in the past financial year 2019-20 sank about 17% to $33.67 billion, the lowest since the 2014-15 fiscal year.
Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/AsiaNewsline and follow us on Twitter at AsiaNewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We'll see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button. Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.